And it's going to be on my front page. I put it. I'll tell people that there is a book. So that's a good book, actually.
You can. Yeah, I don't have it here.
I have it here. So I'm glad you can hear me because I'm using my laptop. So, how's in Vietnam? Is it warm now or cold? Cold, yeah.
It's about to be windy and cold, but not so much. And we still don't have COVID, so we are very lucky.
Oh, good for you.
Yeah. Good so we you. Are able to function more or less the same. The economy is down because there's no tourists. Vietnam is closed to visitors.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Okay. But Ashram is okay, beautiful.
Mm. I'd like to see some photographs of the ashram in Vietnam.
I can send you.
Mm-hmm. Please, yes.
Show us out the window.
Old culture. So we have 1 minute, right?
Yeah, let's give a couple minutes extra because some people might come a little late.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Now is Dak Swami Adi.
My dog. Yeah.
I cannot show much. It's Dak.
You can see the yoga farm. Oh, can't.
Yeah.
My screen doesn't move. Very nice out today. It's sunny today.
Nice.
So where do you live now?
I live now with my daughter in Falls Church, Virginia. It's about 20 minutes from Washington, D.C. So we're still looking for land. We found land, but it's not Vastu Shastra, but I can't find exactly. So I will use some recommendations how to fix it. But at this point, we're hanging in the air for 3 months because it's a forest reservation area, and they have some restrictions on development of areas which will have slopes 25% or more. So that property has beautiful rocks, and I was thinking about Ashram and Grass Valley. It's like a Shiva rock there on the property, and it feels good because a place where we would like to build this flat is just getting there is not flat. So the county has some restrictions, and one guy is extremely stubborn. So he said, no, you can't develop. So we cannot purchase before we know for sure we can develop. So we're waiting for survey. And he's holding us for 2.5 months. And now he's not responding. So I don't know. Today I just got response. And I thought maybe he got sick with COVID or something. But he said, we will do it when there is no snow. I said, it will be snow now because it's winter. So we'll see. But I think it's all divine. And whatever supposed to be, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
And, so I just have to be, we have to be patient, that's all. Mm-hmm. I have a dog in the background. He's licking his plate and it's pretty loud.
It's okay.
Well, five animals, you know, it's like a zoo. Mm-hmm. But they're all at peace. They're not fighting, which is good. Mm-hmm. One came from Costa Rica, I think. And another one came from Krasnoyarsk, Siberia, adopted through Facebook.
Your dogs?
Yes, both dogs. One my daughter adopted, and another one I adopted. And all cats, they're also homeless. So it's like Ashram, you guys are helping people. The last resort to go for people.
I think we can start, Swamiji.
Okay.
Should I say that you want to say the prayer or?
Yes, please. Yes.
You can say Swami Adi.
Om Gijananam Bhutaganadi Sevitam Kapita Jambu Pala Sarbakshutam Umasutam Shokavinashakarnam Namami Vigneshra Pada Pankajam Shadananam Kunkuma Raktavarnam Mahamatim Divya Mayurabhanam Rudrasya Sunam Sarasainyanatam Guham Sadaham Sharanam Prapadiye Ya Kundendu Tushadahara Devala Ya Shubra Vastra Vrita Ya Vinavaradhanda Mandita Kra Ya Shveta Padmasana Ya Brahma Chuta Shankara Pravritabir Devaisara Pujita Samampatu Saraswati Bhagavati Nishesha Jariapaha Om Namah Shivaya Gurave Sachitananda Murtaye Nishprapanchaya Shantaya Shri Shivanandhaya Te Namaha Shri Vishnudevanandhaya Te Namaha Om Saramangala Mangoye Shive Savarta Sarike Sharanye Trambake Gauri Narayani Namostute Narayani Namostute Shanti 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 Om Namah Shivaya everyone. So I'm just going to read the biography of Olga Mandodari, who we're welcoming for the workshop now. So Mandodari is a certified Vastu Shastra consultant. She studied at the International Institute of Mayanic Science and Technology in Chennai, India, under Dr. Stapati Ganapati, who is a world-renowned traditional architect in southern India, who uses Vastu principles in all his projects. Ms. Mandodari earned her MS degree in civil engineering in the University of St. Petersburg, Russia, and associate degree in interior design in Rockville, Maryland, and a PhD from the Open International University. She's affiliated with the International Institute of Integral Human Sciences in Montreal, Canada. She's been teaching for the ashram for many years. She's a TTC graduate also a few years ago, and a great overall person. So we're happy to welcome her. Om Namah Shivaya. Thank you.
Om Namah Shivaya. Thank you so much, Swamiji. Thank you, everybody. Because of you, I get excited and inspired. So every time I try to bring something new, some at least couple new slides into my presentation. So I'm very happy to be with all of you. And I positioned my little desk for the Christmas tree to have the spirit, Christmas spirit. So Vastu Shastra is very ancient. It's about 10,000 years old. And according to some sources, even more, about 15,600. So these teachings came from South India and in India in general, North India, they also practice. I follow South Indian school of Vastu Shastra. As Swamiji mentioned, I was in India and I studied in Chennai or Madras with well-known architect. So the way I was introduced to Vastu Shastra as teachings about architecture and design. So that's why it inspired me, because it really goes along with my professional field, which is now interior design. And I studied architecture, and actually a lot of projects now coming from Russia, believe or not, people are building there. And one building is going to be built on the ashram premises for Mahalakshmi, who is with Shivananda Ashram in Grass Valley. So I designed a house for her strictly according to Vastu Shastra. And I hope I will visit it and we will all enjoy the energy coming out from that building. Because according to these teachings, not only the people will benefit who live in such a house or space designed according to these teachings, but also people around will be sensing that good energy coming from such a building. So in ancient times, it was temples mostly, they were built according to these teachings, but also palaces for wealthy people. And later on, other people started enjoying design according to Vastu Shastra. So mostly these teachings are for new design, new construction. Of course, 90% everything is built up. And people would say, "What? How can I benefit from these teachings?" A lot of pandits in India and other countries, they practice rectification of the space. Most of the pandits, they are astrologers, because some information about Vastu Shastra relates to astrology as well, because it's all energy. So I would like to actually introduce my PowerPoint presentation, because I think it's easy to to comprehend when you have slides, images, illustrating these ancient teachings. And according to what I learned in India, it was my first actually visit in 2005 when I went to see Dr. Ganapati Stapati, with whom I studied. And then I would continue going for many years till he passed away in 2011. So he said that our mind, according to these teachings, because they touch not only construction, but structure of the universe as well. So the and the universe is the universal heart, universal mind. So we're kind of soaked in the consciousness. So everything is built up from units of consciousness. Everything is alive. So he used to say that we think by images. That's how universe does thinking process. So the first image appears in our inner heart, in the mind, and then this image will be manifested into the physical world when the situation, the energy field is ready. So that's why it is important to have images when we study, to have books, illustrated books, because it's easy for us. And it is easy only because the first way of thinking is by images. And then the verbal part is coming, the sound is second. So Swamiji asked me to introduce my book. It's like this small book, and I designed it with one Russian artist, which has a lot of illustrations. Every other page has illustration, because I followed this theory. You have illustration for every thought. So that book is available in Ashram is selling, and also the Amazon is my book. So anyhow, I would like to turn on my presentation. So I will switch my screen. And we will go step by step. My presentation is designed to continue tomorrow, and it's about 60 slides. And also I would like to ask people who are going to participate in the second day tomorrow, you are welcome to bring email to Swamiji, maybe some floor plans. We're going to review them, okay? Because I want this class to be very useful for all of you and give you some tips where to sleep, how to sleep, where to eat, you know, and how to fix if it's not possible to fix at least, you know, certain things to make better and easy for you. So the energy will flow and you will be in the flow of energy. So it will actually support you instead of draining. So that's what the goal of Astroshastra is, to set up the building, the space, that way that it will be plugged in the structure of the universe. So let me share my screen. And so let me start my presentation. So, and then just give me a second. Okay. So let's start. So let's share. Just let me know if you see it.
Okay. Yeah, we see it.
You see it, yeah, but I think I'm sharing. Can you see now?
Yes.
Okay, so this is because the first slide, it was my kind of inner structure of the presentation. This is a slide which is in the view mode. So it's so create healing space with Vastu Shastra, teachings about life energy in buildings. So that is a book I designed for you all, and hopefully somebody will be interested in it because it's really useful. So this is the tools I use. So we have colors, of course. Tomorrow we're going to talk a little bit about colors. There is Swami Shivananda with his great little book called How to Get Sound Sleep. And he has a little chapter exactly about how to sleep. So I have a proof that whatever I received in India, actually from my teacher, is also taught by Swami Shivananda. So there is a correlation. I published several books, and some of them in Russian and one is in English. So let's continue. So what we're going to cover today is very, very simple. So first I will introduce what Vastu Shastra is. It's very important because when we have a deeper knowledge and understanding, then we can actually help ourselves better, because the knowledge is jnana and knowledge is energy as well. So by receiving this knowledge as energy, it's going to be stored inside of you, and you're going to pull this information when you need it. So that's why it is important to introduce the basics of Vastu Shastra, and then we will move to your house, where to sleep, what is the best place for meditation, and I give you suggestions tomorrow about colors, which is not a part of Vastu Shastra, but still it's also energy, and I think you will be interested. So let's move on. Okay, this is according to the Indian tradition. It is important to introduce the guru, teacher, from whom I studied these teachings. This is Dr. Ganapati Stapati. This was 2005. He was a very active man by that time. This is a graduation. He gave me this little clock with Ganesha. So I was very happy, and I got the sari also because he wanted us to wear saris. And as you see on the background, there's a list of things we had to cover during the class. So that's why he would give seminars and educational classes in Chennai. Even the windows you see on the background has kind of like a grid pattern. So that is also according to this teaching. So he was a fascinating man. So the goal of Vastu Shastra, to design and build houses which will be aligned with the grid of energy of the space of the universe. And because of that, it's going to be a resonance of the inner space of the building with the outer space of the universe, actually. So when we have that resonance, when we are in the flow of energy, then the microcosm of our little house and the macrocosm of the whole universe, they are actually connected. They are in resonance, in the kind of like a flow stream in the river of the energy. And so it's called invisible energy, because most of us, we don't see it. Only ancient rishis, they could see actually the structure, and it's a kind of like a grid pattern. I'll show you later. So it is important to create houses according to the specific layout, which is rectangular or square. And if we introduce other shapes, we create movement. So we don't want to have movement in our houses. We want actually peace, because we have enough movement of energy in the outside world. It's very hectic, especially during this age of technology. We have so much information, and information is energy. So we need to design a house which will be exactly the structure of the universe. Then it's going to be peace. And that's what we want to do. So there is a big corpus of literature, according very serious scriptures, and some of them were translated several years ago, like Samarangara Sutradhara. It's two volumes, very interesting. And it's a source information, so root. It's not somebody's explanation. It's actually ancient scripture, which was translated, was found in palm leaves, and then translated not many years actually ago. So it was not accessible for people who speak English and other languages. It was in Sanskrit. So now it's available. It's called Samarangara Sutradhara, two volumes. Then Brihat Samhita is one of the most ancient books about Vastu Shastra. Then there is Maya Matam, Manasaram. So this is Manasaram. It's a well-known scripture. A lot of people use it, especially professionals who studies deeply. Seven volumes. So this is Shilparatna Kosha, Mayamatam. This is only two volumes left, and the rest is lost because the teachings are very ancient, and a lot of information actually got lost through the thousands of years. And some modern researches, one of them I would like to bring to your attention, because this book is not difficult to read. It's called Vastu Sutra Upanishad. This book I recommend anybody who is interested in art and design in general, or just for your general kind of spiritual growth. This book is very interesting, and it's accessible. You can buy it online. It was written by three scholars, Bonner and Baumer and Dr. Sharma. So Alice Bonner, she died already. Dr. Sharma also, and Bonner, She is alive. She is an Indian, and she's from Austria. So they are very serious researchers, and they found in 1950s at two locations parts of the scripture. It describes actually how artists supposed to draw the drawing, how important to position elements in the drawing according to our hierarchy of energies, of devatas, of gods and demons. So that is all there described. And it is also has description about even dot or line, what they mean from the energy point of view. So when we draw something, we already imprint energy. That's why it is important for us to know the source, to know from the beginning, from the dot, how this energy evolves and what the drawings are, what the arts created by people mean, because it is very important what you are hanging in on your walls, in your room, in your bedroom, in your study room, in your living room, because that image is energy and it will impact you. So if we hang somewhere images of animals killed, you know, like people like to hunt, it means that energy is there all the time. So it's not recommended. But most of you are yogis, so I don't need to explain to you that. Yeah, you know. So there is another book. This is Dr. Ganapati Stapati book called Stapatya Veda. That is a very, very valuable book. It's my kind of a desk book, my study book, my textbook. It's called Stapatya Veda. Okay. So, and then some other books, and I would like to also pinpoint this book, Hindu Temple. It's incredible. It's two volumes, and it's by Stella Kramers. She was also from Austria. Unfortunately, she passed away as well. She was in Boston, and I think Philadelphia also. And her private collections are in the United States. So she brought a lot of artifacts from South India, actually, and donated to Museum of Art. Okay, so that is another book which is easy to read. It's called The Hindu Temple by George Mitchell. He is from Australia, and he's a researcher, well-known researcher. In his book, he traveled a lot. He spent more than 25 years, actually, in India studying, and he has a PhD. He really studied the science. And what he, through his research, he found out, because to collect this information is not easy, because stapatis, that's how architects are called in Sanskrit, stapati, it means architect. It's kind of like disappearing knowledge, unfortunately, because it's not as popular. Now it's coming back again. But so to find this information, to preserve it was... you have to put a lot of effort, especially if you're a foreigner, because after the British occupation in India, people were afraid to share because, you know, some of them were killed and who practiced ancient different science like Ayurveda, for example. Yes, so they were afraid after colonization to share. So they tried to keep it in the clan. So you have to basically prove and to behave that way that people will start trusting you and they would like to share with you. So it takes years before you establish yourself as a trustful person and somebody will share with you. So the Hindu Temple is a very valuable book, and it's very interesting what he said there. He said that in India, people believe that it's not only important for people to build the right temple according to Vastu Shastra, but also for the universe. And he said, only if the temple is constructed correctly, according to a mathematical system, can it be expected to function in harmony with the mathematical basis of the universe. So what it means actually, if we build houses and temples not according to these teachings, it means we're building against the structure of the space itself. So we are trying to plug in something in the space, which is energy, a structure which is not resonating, which is across maybe energy lines, crossing them, yeah? So we're not plugging in, but we're trying to forcefully put basically in the structure around us, which we don't see, yeah? But it's there. Something which is incorrect, something which is damaging for the structure of the universe itself. That's why building houses without knowledge of the ancient teachings is also damaging to environment. That's why I think the Kali Yuga is such a sad time for humanity, because we forgot ancient knowledge and we are actually slowly destroying environment. An environment not only physical, but also metaphysical, which we don't see. So these teachings are giving us information how to build properly, how to create your own space to be in resonance with nature and with you as well. Okay, so of course there is a partial, as I mentioned, there is astrology involved here, because astrology is ancient, basically astronomy, because in ancient times, most of you probably know about astrology. I know Swami Sita, Swami Adi, they practice astrology and they know, but for some of you, I would like to share this diagram, because for me, it was, I didn't know astrology and I wanted to know the structure. Astrological structure for myself to comprehend how it works. Because in Vastu Shastra, it says, before we design a house for somebody, we have to get nakshatra of the people who are going to live in the house. And so for me, I had to understand what is nakshatra, how it is all interconnected. So with the universe, with the person and with the house. It was unclear to me when I started. So it took me years actually to comprehend this in detail and in depth. So I bought these two volumes at Shivananda Ashram in Grass Valley, their beautiful bookstore. It was two volumes of this gentleman from India, Dr. Charak. And I went through many books and I found in his book specifically explanation, a simple explanation how before you dive into the astrology, how actually it works in the space. So I build this, I draw this diagram to understand what they're talking about and how it is important for the house. So I'm not going to go in details. You could look at this and later on maybe review it again. So this is the Earth is in the center. And in simple words, we have constellations around. All these constellations are passing energy, different waves of energy to the planet Earth. And we are on the planet Earth receiving that energy. It could be like different rays of energy, radio energy, X-rays, a lot of harmful, actually very strong electromagnetic fields and different rays of energy that our Earth is protecting with atmosphere, yes, we know. But everything is coming to the planet and it affects us. So when we are born, we look at the moment of your birth, where you were born and which constellation was the most powerful. And it was basically beaming its energy into that location where you were born, okay? And that's why it would impact you, because you are living energy as well with that specific set of frequency of their cosmic energy. And it would set up your vibration. So that's why we need to know your vibration. In simple words, in our language, nakshatra is your vibration of your inner space, your soul. And so why, when we find that, then we take that vibration into calculations of the space of the house, physical calculations of the space of the building, which is height with length. Sorry, my dogs are here and they're barking. And I have two dogs here. We're talking about Vastu Shastra. So let's move forward. So because I grew up in Russia and I was an atheist when I was young, and that's how we all grew up. That's why for me, I have to have some proof in order to take it, to trust it. And it's difficult because I'm not an atheist anymore, which is great, because I always from my childhood, I felt that there's something deeper there, yeah? But I had no information when I was growing up in a socialistic country and last century. And slowly and slowly, I was opening up, and in ashram, I received incredible information. And it actually gave me a deep understanding of what I'm doing as a designer, as an architect consultant. So it says that the universe itself has its structure, okay? So, and that's why in this drawing, as you see, actually it's illustration from the book, it shows a grid pattern. So the energy is moving in like channels across the universe. And it has a grid pattern on the 90 degrees intersections. That's how energy is moving in directions. And there are directions there that it's not just random. It is important to find the direction of the energy on the planet Earth. And I will tell you how. We basically use Google Earth, because in ancient times they had some techniques, but now we have Google Maps or any other maps. And the usually maps, they always show the north is vertically up, and we need geographic north. So we actually, the grid of the universe is along the energy lines of meridians and parallels on the planet Earth. Of course, they're kind of like we have to visualize, because physically we don't see them, but they're there, but they're much smaller. And I will tell you what it is. So according to these teachings, universe is pulsating, and it has a pulse in eights. So eight is considered as the most sacred number. So how is it? So this cube here, as you see, it's a kind of golden cube. It says in the scriptures that the universe is built up from tiny little cubes of divine energy, which is consciousness itself. So the first manifestation of consciousness into the material world is this little tiny cubes of energy called paramanu, para super anu atom. So this little atom, it's not what our scientists are calling atom. It's different here. So they call this unit of energy, living energy, a life energy, unit of consciousness, they call it paramanu. So that little particle of energy is also inside of us. And it's the whole universe is built up with tiny, tiny little cubes of energy. And it vibrates and pulsates in eights. So it blinks one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So the speed of this pulsation is equivalent, according to Surya Siddhanta, that's where it's described. It's equivalent to one blinking of an eye. So one time we blink, one time, it means the universe sent eight pulses. So that's why eight is a very sacred number. Okay. So, and this is how it looks like. See, so the whole universe has this grid pattern. It's called primal energy grid or macrocosm. And the small one is the tiny little cube, paramanu. And inside, it can be divided infinitively into eight by eight. That's the nature of our energy pattern in our universe, okay? So that is called Vastu Purusha Mandala. So Vastu is pure, is energy. Purusha is soul, because it's living, it knows everything. And mandala is a design. So it's basically divine design. And it's simple, it's just straight lines intersecting under 90 degrees, because the whole structure made from tiny little cubes. Okay, so I wanted to prove for you, because I wanted proof for myself. So actually I shared with Swami Sita, because I was so excited that I found just recently for myself, I searched on internet, for some research which would somehow connect these ancient teachings to their modern knowledge. So this gentleman, his name is Jason Padgett. He was an ordinary man till 29, I think. And then at 29 years old, he was attacked and heavily beaten by some hooligans. And so he got actually a concussion. And after that horrible incident of his life, he acquired called savant syndrome. So it's a rare situation when somebody has an incredible gift of something. Maybe you probably most of you saw the movie called The Rain Man. He was savant, okay? So this gentleman, he is not severely impaired, but he is fully functioning. After that, what happened to him, he started seeing differently than everybody else. So he started seeing everything in patterns. And he said, it looks like geometry is embedded in everything, in the water, which is going in there, you know, swirling in the sink. It is in the ray of light coming on the, you know, from the sun. He sees patterns, geometric patterns. We don't see it with our, you know, ordinary eyes, but something happened with his brain and he started seeing. And why I am bringing here this information to you, because what he said, it was, I got tears even in my eyes when I heard what he said. Let me just play a little bit, except 2 minutes, yeah? And I will explain to you why it is important what he said.
Mandori.
Yes, you can't hear?
When you, I'm gonna stop your share. When you share, you have to choose the option to share computer audio and optimize. So let me just stop your share for a second.
Okay.
And now if you reshare, there should be two checkboxes and it says like optimize for computer audio.
Oh, yeah, optimize sharing for video and computer sound. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so let's share. Okay. Okay. So is the, do you see, so you yeah. see the slide, yeah. yeah? Okay, let's start from the beginning. I don't know if I can, okay, yes.
Injury, everything did not look fluid to me anymore. In other words, that fluidity of motion was gone. When something moved, I was extremely aware of the picture frames. If something moved fast, the picture frames were further apart. And if something moved slower, the picture frames were closer together. And the rate that the picture frames changed relative to the speed of light was their velocity. And it also gave everything a slightly pixelated quality. It's like everything that is moving relative to a matrix or a grid structure like pixels on a television screen.
So he said exactly what I wanted to share with you. He said that everything was moving like picture frames, and it was like a little kind of jerky movements, not like smooth as we see with our eyes. He started seeing actually a grid pattern. That's what he said. And that grid pattern is really there. So for me, it was another proof that this science, what I'm practicing now, is true. For me, this is so important. And I hope, you know, this will be also interesting for you, because this gentleman actually sees the images of everybody walking as picture frames, like a movie. That is Vedanta. Vedanta is telling us to actually, that we are just like a projection on the divine screen. And that's what he sees. He sees like an old picture, like a movie, like a slide. So when he sees screenshots moving after one after another one. Yeah, so he doesn't see anymore as we do. He sees actually pretty much what is really there. And because we don't have that quality, it doesn't mean it's not there. And so this man proved to me that these ancient teachings brought to us by ancient seers like Brahmarishi Mayan and Dr. Ganapati Stapati, they are actually talking about real stuff. And that is amazing. So let's, so the goal of Astu Shastra is to bring harmony, health, peace, and prosperity to everybody. And actually spiritual bliss, because living in like this space, so going to such a temple, you feel the energy. You feel their energy of peacefulness, because the shape of the house, which is designed according to this invisible structure, brings us peace. Because the first was just peace, and then the movement came, and movement of thought. So the thoughts are forcing things to move, everything. First on the subtle level, and then on the physical level. That's why when we think, we get tired, because we're actually spinning inside of us, because this little particle of energy is also inside of everybody's body, and it's called Jivatma, okay? So the Jivatma and Paramatma, they have the same exact structure. That's why we're in the image of God, as Bible would say, yeah? Because we have exactly the same structure as divine. So, but most of us, we don't know, or maybe we know, but we don't practice, okay? So this is a little diagram, yeah? This is Vastu Purusha Mandala. That's how the Brahmins would draw it for a ceremony. So all these little squares at the perimeter, they have little other energies inside, and they have their own qualities. That's why it is important to know where to place your front door, because you want to place your front door where the energy is positive, where it's not destructive. That's why they would describe where to place the door when we design a house, okay? So this is another interesting information for you about this grid structure in this space. In 2014, it was a discovery, it was an article about discovery that our brain actually has like this structure. And this structure is, so the neurons in the brain, they intersect under 90 degrees. And this is a Vastu Purusha Mandala, which is created by cladding patterns. When, you know, now on the internet, you could see it. People do experiments with sound, and it's like a plate, metal plate, and the like powder is on it. And they would create specific frequency of the vibration, and it would create a pattern. And this pattern is called cladding pattern. After one physicist and scientist from Germany in 1870s, he rediscovered this pattern. So this is 796 hertz, and it creates like this pattern. It's like a mandala, basically, Vastu Purusha Mandala. So that is a sound. It's a cross section of the sound of 796 frequency. So the Panchabhuta elements, we have to bring it here, because the space itself, when it evolves from invisible structure into the physical world, it has stages of transformation from the subtle energy, which is called invisible, or it's Vastu with one A. It's a pure energy, and it starts its manifest into the physical world to show their beauty of the nature. We see now, you know, constellations, stars, and we have our solar system, we have a planet Earth with all the plants and human beings and animals. So all that is made up from the same exact energy, but it has a different frequency. That's why we have different forms, different colors, because of this Panchabhutas embedded into these structures, and they dominate in different ways, creating specific frequencies. So the peace is when all these Panchabhutas are actually at resonance with each other. They don't dominate. They actually settled in the structure of the house at the appropriate corners of the building. That's where the Panchabhutas is the five creative elements. Yeah, if, most of you probably know, because you're with associated with ashram, because they teach you that. So Pancha is five, Bhuta is element. So Panchabhuta, creative elements, Pancha five. So what is it? It's space, Akasha. It is air. It's first is subtle air, then the physical air comes, yeah? Then it's fire, then it's water, and that's earth, the heaviest element. So when we know about these elements, we know actually what is going on in our building. So in ancient times, they would simply design like this hut. And so the north direction, we would find the northeast, you know, south, west. It was important because we had to position our house according to cardinal directions. That's how energy moves. That's why we need to plug it in the grid of energy of the universe. And the earth by itself, by default, has exactly the same grid of energy inside. And so that's why we have basically the movement of the planet. It's along its own axis because it's alive. So it's spinning because the mind of the Earth is also functioning. It's alive. So when it thinks, it spins. So it thinks all the time. Yeah. So we are spinning with Earth. So we need to make sure that we are positioning our houses according to the grid of energy of the Earth. And so that's why we know that north is the direction on the map. We can find it. And it says that the northern direction brings us basically physical wealth, money. So that's why a lot of people, they want for offices, front door facing north, because that's where their wealth is coming, monetary wealth, yeah? So the most important element, as I mentioned, the first was space, which is Brahma Stan. Brahma is creative stan, place, place for creation. So this is first, which is in the center of the building, which is the heart of the building. Then second is air. So the energy actually slows down. Here it's like a nuclear energy field. You don't want to sleep here because you will not be able to sleep peacefully because it's too energizing for you, okay? So the next one is the air. So the air is slower than the Akashic energy, but it's still moving. That's why we don't want to sleep there because it will move you out from your building. So it's recommended to have guest bedrooms so they don't stay long with you, okay? Or children, because they grow and they go. Or elderly people, because they go at one point as well. So this could be a guest bedroom, okay? So then the fire comes after the air. So it's hot, but it moves slower than air actually. And so this is, of course, it's for kitchen because that's the subtle fire, and the physical fire comes from the subtle fire. That's why we should cook here. We should not sleep because this will be creating a lot of heat if we sleep here. So we won't be able to sleep well. Then the next element is water. So we all build up from water, what 75% the middle age, yeah? But when we're born, it's about 90% we're water. So that's why water element is very healing for everybody. That's why in the northeast zone of the house, it's good to have your prayer room, your altar, your puja room or study. And if you don't have anywhere place to sleep, then this is a place to sleep as well, because it will bring you peace. But this is kind of active peace. So your mind is at peace, but it's the best location to work from home. Most of us now work from home who can, and that's where you should locate your desk, northeast corner of your apartment or house. And the last element, which is earth, which is heavy, it has all five elements in it: space, air, fire, water. And that's why earth is very heavy and it has everything in it. And that's why it gives life to everything. So the earth element is peaceful, heavy, and it brings us to sleep. That's why if you bring your bedroom here, you position your bed in this corner, southwest corner of your house. That is for master bedroom. Okay, so if your children sleep in their zone of earth, or whoever is sleeping but not you, it means these people are going to actually dominate you in your household because they are with this powerful element earth, which is having everything. And it's kind of like ownership of the building. So it is recommended only for the owners of the building to sleep in the southwest area of their house. And so you see how you could also arrange your spaces in between. So this is treasury, money, and also in India, they call it drawing room where people get together. So in ancient times, again, because the ladies were separated from males, so they would gather in the eastern direction. Nowadays we're all together. So this is a good space for children to play also, and you know, for anybody to be here is fine. So between the southwest and southeast, we have south direction, That's a good for dining room. So you're close to kitchen, very convenient. And so that is a good place to have dining room. So this could be a family room, or also dining room if you don't have other location for children, or just a family room, okay? So the Brahmasthan, as I mentioned briefly, that is a central place in the building. So Brahmasthan is a very, very special place because it has this akasha, pure space, which should not be occupied with anything. So in India, they make this opening even to the sky in the Brahmasthan, which is a central part of the building. Okay, so they would cover here with a plastic tarp so the rain doesn't fall, but they could open it actually and have fresh air because it's so warm, they can do it. In our climates, we can have skylight here. If we don't have it, it's okay. But if we want to have more energy, it's highly recommended to have a skylight in the center of the building. Maybe some of you noticed that some hotels, they have a very peaceful atmosphere and specifically Four Seasons, it's a very expensive hotel. And whenever I would go there for maybe some gatherings or wedding, one time I was invited, I noticed that a lot of these Four Seasons hotels, they would have atrium. So this big open space in the center, and it would have a huge skylight. And so people would actually gather in that center. They would have cafeteria, maybe, you know, just sitting areas with plants and stuff. And so it kind of like people gravitate to that space because it feels peaceful. And it feels peaceful because it is Brahmasthan. It is a creative energy of space, divine energy. That's why it is important to clean that area. If you have clutter in the center of your house, you should clean it up, okay? Because that energy is a briefing, basically, with consciousness, with the energy is coming from the space. So energy comes from the space vertically on the planet Earth, and also the energy from the core of the planet comes from underground. So these energies move together, they merge, and they start spinning clockwise direction in the Brahmasthan area. So in the northern hemisphere, it says energy moves clockwise. In the southern hemisphere, is counterclockwise. So most of us, we are now in the northern hemisphere, so that's why staircases should go clockwise direction going up to the second floor, because that's how energy moves. And maybe you noticed in Hindu temples, people go around shrine clockwise direction as well when they pray, because the energy is moving that way. So they want to be in the flow of energy. So that is about Brahmasthan. And as you see here, they even have this kind of inner balcony. So it doesn't go in the Brahmasthan, it's cut out, and it has this open space to the second floor, to the first floor. Okay, so Ayati calculations. So now we're getting to this very intricate part of the teachings. Ayati means to translate basically or explain what this term means. It means searching for the source, for the energy source. So as I mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, that we have to calculate energy of a person or people who are going to live in the house when it's a new construction, yeah? So we use this Ayati formulas. There are six of them for the house and 16 for the temple. So it's more precise. So Ayati means searching for the source, pure source, and also the universal source. And so in order to use these formulas, we bring into the resonance your energy, house's energy, because we calculate dimensions of the house. So we set up a proper vibration of the house where you're going to live. And that vibration will be resonating with the universe as well. So this is a really universal knowledge which brings peace to the building and peace to people who are going to live there. And because this building is going to be in some neighborhood, it will actually radiate a good energy from itself. And so the neighbors would feel that as well, because it's going to be a big structure, relatively big, yeah? So it will actually create a good energy field around. So this diagram is a small house I designed for one Swami in Bahamas. So she gave me dimensions, what she would like to have. And according to her nakshatra, to her vibration, we are in the dimensions she wanted to have her space. The formula would show that her front door should be from the south. And a lot of people in India, they don't want to have actually a door from the south. They think south is a direction of God Yama, who is a god of death, but also it is a god of destiny. So we should not be afraid of it. And according to Vastu Shastra, according to Vastu Purusha Mandala, there are two doors on the south side of the house, which would be beneficial for people. So there is nothing to be scared of. It's just people who don't know exactly these teachings, they are scared. Yeah, they don't have complete information. So we have the south door, which is in the fourth pada or square or rectangular. If we basically put a grid pattern here in the building, it's supposed to be actually 9 by 9. And then you would see one, two, three, fourth space would be the door. So this is a good door. So Swami told me, oh, that's great for me because I'm not concerned about money anymore. I'm concerned about my spiritual growth. South would work for me. So that's how I designed this little space. So this is a little kitchen zone, southeast corner, yeah? This is our Brahmastan divine energy, so we don't want to put anything there. So your bed will be here. You could sleep with your head toward east. Just remember that it's the best actual direction. And Swami Shivananda explained that in his little book, how to get sound sleep, why it is. So it's according to the energy movement. So when you're lying down in your bed with your head toward east is the best direction for you because your energy will be recharged during night. You're not going to lose energy. You're going to be along the line, which is east-west line. And it's also called Brahma Sutra. So the energy of divine is flowing along the line east-west. Divine energy also flows according to other lines, north-south as well. But according to these teachings, it's not recommended to sleep with your head toward north, because you will be losing energy. It's too energizing for you. So the first is east, the second is south, and the third one is okay, west. So the best is east or south, okay? So that's how we designed it. And the northwest areas, you see we have like a kind of air zone, so you could relax, read your books here. And now northeast corner, that's the altar's area, yeah? So you could put your, whatever you believe in your life, a Christian or a Buddhist or a Hindu, or if you don't even believe in anything, you could just put the symbol of nature, okay? Or you could put Ganesha there. Whatever is close to your heart, the northeast corner is the corner for prayer, for meditation, for puja. That is according to these teachings, okay? So that is a simple kind of little space to show you how you can position in one room even. Even if you don't have a house, you have just a room, you could follow exactly the same rules of Vastu Shastra, okay? So they're exactly the same for the house or for the room. And because they call it fractals, so this space has the same qualities. You could look at this as the entire house, or you could look at this as just one room where you maybe spend all your time now, yeah? So you could arrange your space like this. You find where is your north, you find the east, west, and you try to arrange your space according to this diagram. It will help you to find more peace at home. Okay, so where is your best place to sleep? I just mentioned that we should sleep in the earth zone, right, which is southwest. Let's say somebody sleeps in the attic, Yeah, maybe your bedroom is in the attic. So it is not recommended to sleep under the sloped roof, because that is a movement of energy. So that's why this little beautiful illustration from my book actually shows you that you should move your bed from the roof under the ceiling, which will be still there, hopefully. It's not just cathedral space. I would recommend to have just actually built that flat space above your head when you're asleep. If you can't do it, because in some houses it was very popular and it's still popular, recessed ceiling. So it means that you have lighting, and it means your ceiling is not flat, but it has elevation kind of drop. And that's where they put lighting. So it's kind of beautiful, but for sleeping, it's not good because your energy drops there. So, and there is a line. If you have that elevation change, it means there is a line here, and every line is a line of energy. So that line actually cuts through the space, yeah, like an invisible wall, and it will cut you through. So you don't want that. So you want to move your bed under the flat area. If you don't have it, then arrange or build or buy a bed with canopy. It's called canopy bed. So you could create a nice little space with a flat surface above your head. So in any situation, you can find a way how to make it more comfortable for yourself, okay? So this is all directions. So see this one showing to north. So north we don't want. So we have east, south, and west. So the ideal is east, second is south, and west is the last one, okay? So where is the best place for meditation? Remember I told you, so meditation is the northeast corner of your room or your house. So in the northeast corner, we should do meditation, puja, home office, because that is an area of invisible water. So it's very, very peaceful, and it is good for your mind. Your mind gets peaceful in that area. So that's why you could dream about wherever the dreams are here. And so that is actually the place where you could generate your dreams, and they will manifest. Why? Because the northeast corner is the place of peacefulness. So the energy is very subtle, and it's still closer to our inner structure, because we, as I said, we're 75% physical water. So it's actually very close to our physical body, that energy. And it's still active because it's not earth where you're supposed to sleep. So you could actually dream there. So the dream, and if you dream every day about specific thing which you would like to happen in your life, do it in the northwest corner. By doing it every day, you're building up like a hologram the energy of your dream, because it's actually a three-dimensional energy picture. So it's a structure. So when you dream, you actually emit energy. So it's good to emit energy in the northwest corner, dream energy, and it will manifest. So dream about specific thing every day, and it's going to happen, because every day you add a little bit more to the structure of that thing, whatever you want to happen in your life. Okay, so you're building up your life, your destiny with dreaming. So that's why in yoga, they say it's best when we don't dream, because that's the closest way to enlightenment. But, you know, we live in this world, and we do have, of course, our desires. So it's good to have peaceful desires. So the place to manifest your dreams is the northeast corner. Okay, so I would highly recommend to create a more peaceful space in your room, in the sense of decorations, because as I mentioned earlier, the any artwork, any pictures, they are imprints of energy. That's why we correlate we connect right away to certain things because our energy somehow resonates with specific pieces of art. That's why people like, certain people like one thing, another other set of people would like something else. Why? Because we say everybody has different taste. So why do we have different taste? Because our inner energy at that point of time in our life, our energy vibrates with specific frequency because of the situations in our lives, because of our dreams, because of our close ones, because where we are. So all together creates kind of like a cocktail of different energies. And that's why you, as a human being, you are longing for peace. And if these energies are energizing, maybe too much energizing, then you're actually looking for something more peaceful. So the photographs of the nature are the most peaceful. But let's say somebody is in depression. Yeah, you don't want to move, you don't want to go anywhere, you just want to sit and do nothing. Because something happened, because of your thoughts, you know, because of the situation. In order to help yourself to get out from that mode of kind of depression, it is recommended to have more brighter colors. So energizing colors, we will talk more about this tomorrow, but I'll just give you some ideas. Up in the kitchen area, it is best to have more vibrant colors like oranges, terracotta colors, because they actually support digestion, because they bring this fiery energy. That's why fire is an orange color, because that is divine energy of the invisible fire. It's the same color, actually. So that's why if you don't have enough energy, you need to be more motivated, bring more accents in your room with more kind of orangey elements. But don't paint your walls, because at one point in orange color, red color, because at one point you will have enough of that inner energy and it will start irritating you. That's why our taste changes, because our inner interior changes. Our inner energy changes. That's why we change our tastes and desires for wearing certain colors or surrounding ourselves by different pieces of art. That's why I would recommend to make changes in accessorizing your space. Because if, let's say, here, instead of this big wall of this mural, it's kind of like a photo paper. Yeah, you could have maybe something like more energizing, but you may get tired. So it is recommended to have, my battery is low. I hope my computer is low. Julia, can you help me, please?
Working, I see everything.
Yeah, okay, good. Oh, my dog is here. I don't know. I think somewhere is a disconnect or something, but hopefully, this is my dog, Lucy. Lucy, stop. Lucy, could you check it? Oh, I don't know why it's a battery. Okay, so hopefully we'll be okay. Okay, so, so bring more elements of, kind of in your accessories, like lampshades, they could be orangey, yeah? Vases, tablecloth, something which you can change later. So in nature, we have 90% green colors, you noticed, right? Because actually, even in interior design, designers know that the green color is in between hot and cold. So it's intermediate. So it's a very pacifying and peaceful. So the more greens you have in your house, it's better, because it's actually a dominating color of life, of environment, of nature. That's why you will never go wrong using green shades of color of green. Yeah. So when you don't know, use different colors of green. And then you know for sure it's not going to irritate you later. It actually brings you peace. Okay. So suggestions about colors of the walls I just mentioned. So also texture is important. We're talking here about elements, panchabhutas. Yeah. We know that we have five senses. So the when we see something, we absorb actually with our eyes, with our actually body, with the surface of the skin, we absorb energy which is coming upon us from our environment, from the landscapes, from surroundings. That's why people are gravitating to little creeks, because they hear this repetitive sound. A repetitive sound is actually vibration of the universe. So that's why a lot of people are driven to go to the ocean, because we hear that repetition of the waves. Yeah, they come a specific frequency that actually is a frequency of the cosmos, because the moon is there, moon is in the space, and there are tides are related to the moon. So, and the moon is a partial, is sunk in the cosmic energy. So the energy around is this vibration of divine. So the vibration is divine, affecting physical bodies. And that's why ocean has this specific wave sound, because they're in the mode of rhythm. So rhythm is very important. So when we hear rhythmic music, we actually becomes more peaceful. I'm not talking about rap, because that's when we need to be energized and people listen to that. I'm talking to something which we're liking in nature. So the sound of water is always peaceful. You can always bring into your house a little tiny fountain, put it on your desk in the south, in the northeast corner where the water is, yeah? And turn it on. So actually that sound will bring you more peace. If you feel like you don't need it, turn it off. So textures are also important, right? So the texture is coming to the touch. So because we're in the house and you know, some like in California, you guys have lockdown. So it's good to have also nice textures in your rooms where you are. It is very popular nowadays for God knows many years by now. In Home Depot, you can go and see the tiles of natural pebbles. It is good to actually step on the pebbles. And most of you who knows Ayurveda, you know that we have this acupuncture points on our feet, yeah? So it is good to actually walk bare feet in the house if it's not cold, yeah? And because you will be feeling texture of your rug, or you could even buy this little, you know, several maybe tiles of this pebble, so put them somewhere, and you take off your socks and walk daily, yeah, because this would be exercise for your sensation of texture. So you will energize the points through your feet. The energy will flow into your body. That's why we go for massage, right? So you do the massage to create some textures on your floor, to walk bare feet and choose to energize yourself, to wake up your energy so we don't sit still days, you know, with computers as we do now. Just give yourself 15, 30 minutes of sensing the different patterns, colors, textures. So to exercise your panchabhutas inside, yeah? Because they do need to be exercised. Otherwise, we're kind of falling asleep. So that is important. And about indoor plants, there is a whole chapter in Shastras describing what plants to have. Again, follow the same understanding that colors are important for you because they're, you know, the plants are, they have flowers and they bloom. And so pick the ones which you feel like you need. You don't have to follow blindly all the suggestions. You have to always give yourself space to listen to your inner voice. It's your soul. What is asking? Because if you feel like you need a little bit more oranges, yes, add it to your interior. Yeah? If you need something, other colors, add it to your interior. So these herbs, actually, they are described in Upanishads as like basilic. It's a holy plant. And we know it actually, you know, we use it in food. And it is antiseptic as well. So they don't recommend to have cactus because it's spiky. So the energy actually is spiky in the cactus. I know people like cacti because, you know, they also bloom beautifully. But according to these teachings, it's not recommended to have at home spiky plants because they have spiky energy. Okay. So I think, yes, I wanted to give you 5 minutes to listen to Dr. Ganapati Stapati. He's going to speak in English and sometimes in Tamil, but you will have subtitles. And I would like you to listen what he was saying. This documentary was created in 1985. So it's an old movie. He was, he died in 84. It was 2011. So he was much younger. And this actual documentary received award of the best documentary of that year in India. It's called Shilpi Speaks. So Shilpi is also a word, Sanskrit word, meaning sculptor. So Dr. Stapati was also a wood sculptor. In his stone yard, they would create gods and goddesses for temples in India. So he was a sculptor as well as an architect. So let's listen what he was saying, because this is very interesting. Just keep attention on the subtitles. They will be there, okay? It's about 5 minutes or 4.5 minutes.
மூலத்திலே ஒரு பெரிய வஸ்து ஒன்று உண்டு, அதுக்கு வஸ்து என்றான் பெயர். அந்த மூலமே வடிவங்களாக மாறுவது உண்டு. மூலம் மாறிய வடிவங்கள் இருக்கின்றனவே அவர்களுக்கெல்லாம் வாஸ்து என்ற பெயர். பூமியே அதே மாதிரி மூல பொருளாக மூல வஸ்துவாக கொள்வதுண்டு. அந்த பூமியே வடிவங்களாக மாறுகின்றன, கட்டடங்களாக மாறுகின்றன, சிற்பங்களாக மாறுகின்றன, அவையெல்லாம் வாஸ்து என்று சொல்லப்படும்.
என் தேகம் கனன்று எரிகின்றது. குரலும் உடலும் கைகளும் படைக்க துடிக்கின்றன. மண்ணுள் அமிழ்ந்து எழுகிறேன். விண்ணிலிருந்து விடை வருகிறது. மண்ணிலிருந்து அவன் தேகத்தை படைக்கிறேன். விண்ணிலிருந்து அவன் இருப்பிடத்தை உருவாக்குகிறேன். பூமியின் அழகும் வனப்புமே என் மூலமும் முதலீட்டும். உடலே என் படைப்பின் கருவி.
திருவாசியிலே தோரணத்திலே ஆரம்பத்திலே மகரம் காட்டப்பட்டிருக்கிறது சொன்னால் என்னதென்று சொல்ல முடியாத நிர்குணமான ஒரு நிலையிலிருந்து பிரளையிலிருந்து இந்த உலகமானது தோன்றி அதன் பிறகு மேல் பகுதியில் ஒரு சிம்மத்தினுடைய முகம் வைக்கப்பட்டிருக்கும். உக்ரமான நிலையை உலகமானது அடைந்து பராக்கிரமத்தை அடைந்து அதன் பிறகு படிப்படியாக கீழே இறங்கி மீண்டும் லயமாக மாறுகிறது. இதற்கு பெரும் சிற்பியாக இருக்கக்கூடிய அந்த ஆன்ம பொருள் இருக்கிறதே என்று ஒவ்வொரு தெய்வத்தினுடைய பின்னணியிலே இப்போ ஏற்பட தோரணமானது வைக்கப்படுகிறது. இந்த பிரபஞ்சத்தில் மறைந்து உறைந்திருக்கக்கூடிய பொருளைத்தான் ஆன்மா என்று சொல்கிறோம். ஆகாசமாக வெளிப்பட்டு நிற்கின்றது என்று சொல்கிறோம். அப்பேற்பட்ட வெளியேறக்கூடிய அந்த ஆகாசமானது நமது உடம்புக்குள்ளேயும் இருக்கிறது என்று சொல்கிறோம். ஆக ஆன்ம சக்தி வியாபித்த ஒரு பொருளாக வெளியே இருக்கக்கூடிய ஆகாசமும் நம்மளுடைய உடம்புல இருக்கக்கூடிய ஆகாசமும் இருக்கின்றது. அப்படி அந்த ஆகாசமாகிய அந்த பொருள் உள்ளமென்றும் பேசப்படும். அதுக்கு பேருள்ளம் என்று பெயர், இதற்கு சிற்றுள்ளம் என்று பெயர். அந்த பேருள்ளம் என்னென்ன காரியங்களெல்லாம் செய்ய முடியுமோ அப்பேற்பட்ட காரியங்களெல்லாம் இந்த உள்ளே இருக்கக்கூடிய சிற்றுள்ளமும் செய்யும். இன்னும் சொல்லப்போனால் சிற்றுள்ளம் செய்யக்கூடிய அத்தனை காரியங்களுமே அதுவும் செய்யும். நாம் எப்படி படைக்கிறோம், நாம் எப்படி உருவங்கள் எல்லாம் உண்டாக்குகிறோம், அப்படித்தான் அந்த ஆன்மா பிரபஞ்சமாக மாறுகிறது, பிரபஞ்சமாக உருமாறுகிறது.
Okay, so that was basically a fragment from the movie, a documentary by Dr. Ganapati Stapati and his explanation. So tomorrow we're going to move forward with the next part of the lecture. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen. And if you would like to, you can, we have 11 minutes. I can answer questions if somebody has some questions maybe. So tomorrow we're going to talk about colors and which color is for what, how it would benefit us to which colors to choose actually. That would be from another teachings which relate to the same kind of energy teachings called spectrochrome by some other Indian man. He is dead by now, unfortunately, but he was from northern India. And I would like to introduce the color therapy for you tomorrow. But today, so we spoke about the basics of Vastu Shastra and explained to you where to sleep is the best, you know, what, where to eat, you know, it's all described. So I would say the most important to take from this lecture is to clean up the central space of the room where you're spending most of your time, right? So you take the all unnecessary things from there, because that is the Brahmastan, your small, tiny Brahmastan, even in one room. So each room has its own tiny Brahmastan, okay, the energy of creation. So you clean it up. If you have something heavy there, chair, move it and create a space and see how you feel about it. You will notice the changes. It may not instantly, but you will notice, okay? So first clean up your Brahmastan, okay? Second, check where you sleep. So how to do that? You go to Google Earth, or just Google Maps, type your address and search, and then zoom in and you will see the building where you are. I will show you tomorrow if somebody needs it. Yeah? So you will see how your building is positioned on the map, in the Google map. If it's under the angle like 45 degrees, it means your building has so much movement because it's not along the grid lines, because the grid line's like this, yeah? And it's like this. So that's why you may not have a lot of peace in your house because it's moving all the time. So don't worry about it, because with this knowledge, the knowledge actually will help you to find a better place if it's necessary, yeah? Because when we know, we start dreaming. Starting dreaming, it means we're building up our future. Okay, so check out where you sleep. So hopefully not toward north, you can change that at least. If you cannot move your bed, at least you can move your pillow, right? So check that kitchen, see where you cook. So if you sleep in the fire zone, take some other place and sleep on the sofa somewhere and see the difference. You will see that it's going to be more peaceful. Make sure you are not sleeping in the southeast corner of your building, okay? I mean, your house or room, okay? Check it out. So what else? So you can have a little fountain, you know, bring it home or buy online. have incense because they are actually signifying, burn them a lot because the low frequency energies, they don't like smoke. That's why in ancient times in many churches, they would use, in Russia, they would use a special thing, you know, the smoke. In India, they use incense. Yeah, so because the low type of energies, they don't like that. That's why burn incense, the more you can, the better. And the ideal place is, of course, your altar, and also northwest corner. Yes, that's where the air is. So you can bring your incense there. So basically, that's so check all these elements and see how you are. And tomorrow I will answer more questions. And the first day you will go back to where you are, check it out, and I will answer all your questions tomorrow. Okay, Swamiji, so we have 7 minutes. And
someone is asking relationship between feng shui and vastu, and if you know any differences between them.
Yeah, it's a very good question. I started with feng shui many years ago, and I found several books. It was 2003 when I started, okay? So it was not too many books in the US. Now it's more, and feng shui became very, very popular in the United States and around the globe. What I found through my research, that feng shui is about 3,000 to 5,000 max years old, according to what we know now. Vastu Shastra is more than 10,000 years old. I also found, so there is a connection there, because both teachings are talking about energies. The difference is, it's like a different instrument. You may play violin, or you may play piano, okay? So the piano is one instrument, and the violin is another. So we could say a feng shui is maybe a violin, and Vastu Shastra is a piano, maybe. There is a difference. I had one gentleman, he came from New York to study with me several years ago. He was feng shui master. He said, I have several Indian couples. They want me to do Vastu Shastra, and I don't know. So he gave me his book. He wrote the book, and he said, how strange. In feng shui, if you have a front door, you open front door, and you see the other side of the house, like a window, on that line, it means a house of poverty, they call it. In Vastu Shastra, it's totally opposite. They say, we have to have that, because the energy has to circulate. We can't keep it stagnant. So there are differences. So that's why I think it's good to follow either feng shui or Vastu Shastra. I would not recommend mixing. It's like allopathic doctor or homeopathic doctor, yeah? So, you know, they have different type of treatment. That's why I would recommend to follow one specific direction. So I don't know much about feng shui, because when I started, I bought the books, I couldn't find a teacher, and then I found Vastu Shastra, I found my guru, and that was it. So for me, that was, I switched basically. So that's why I can't give a comprehensive answer, because I don't know much, I know very little. But I would be interested to know more about it. But I do, it's my personal opinion. I think that Vastu Shastra is older, and I think feng shui started from Vastu Shastra, because there is a scripture, it's about Surya temple in northeast India, near Bhubaneswar. It's a huge Surya temple, beautiful. They found writings of Chinese travelers who were describing their experiences in India. So a lot of actual Chinese travelers were coming to India, and they would learn a lot of things. And possibly they would bring it back and put it all together. And so the China evolved as China with their own spiritual teachings, a lot of Buddhism is there, right? So, and Vastu Shastra has, I would say Vastu Shastra has much more source literature, root literature, because unfortunately during Cultural Revolution in China, a lot of things were burned out, like a lot of books were burned. So lots of information is lost. That's why it's just for me, I feel more comfortable with Vastu Shastra. I don't know what it is, but it gives me a lot of information and understanding. And plus, because I have my Vastu Guru in India, that's why I feel comfortable. So there are two different teachings, but both about energy. And I think it's all about the same, but with different approach. So that's how I answer. Any other questions you have?
When you were talking about manifesting your dreams, is that done by setting intentions?
Yes, yes. So it's good to actually monitor your dreams, because by doing that, we're focusing on specific things, yeah? And not randomly developing a lot of different thoughts, because that's what happens with most of us. We have so many dreams, and that's what yoga is teaching us, to actually to try to calm down with breathing, with pranayama, to have lesser dreams, lesser desires, but then focus maybe on the most important, what you need in your life, and be at the northeast corner where your meditation area is, and that's where you should meditate, focusing on specific point of what you want to have, and you can visualize it. By visualizing, you're actually drawing a subtle structure with your energy. It's not just something random thought. It's actually a mission of energy. And if you know what you're doing, then you're actually focusing on your dream. So you're visualizing with closed eyes in the northeast corner of what you want to have. You could visualize colors of what you would like to have, shapes, events, with whom, or whatever is your dream. You should visualize vividly with colors, with motion and emotion. And then it will happen. And that, it's just how it works. That's what part of the, there is a scripture, Ayin Tiran, also published by Dr. Ganapati Stapati. It's all about energy. And it's by ancient architect Mayan, Brahmarishi Mayan. And Mandodri was actually his daughter. That's why Dr. Stapati gave him that name. Because I, so much knows, I came after tsunami right away. And he said, you were not scared of tsunami. You came to India anyway. I'll call you Mandodri, because he could not remember my name. So Mandodri, that's what my spiritual name also. So I said I initiated with that name. So yeah, so manifestation of your thoughts, it's good to be in the northeast corner, in a peaceful environment. You can clean your space with incense and the bell, because bell destroys also low kind of energies. That's why also many cathedrals, temples, they all have bells, because it destroys specific unnecessary energy, and then you start creating positive energy there. Okay, so you could use your bell, incense, clean up the space with all that, and you sit in the clean space, clean body after yoga, you could start your meditation. Pick the same time as you create a habit. Of course, to suggest it's very easy. Doing that is not easy, because most of us were just like, just too much. Anyway, yeah. Anything else?
I think that's it.
Okay, so we're going to meet tomorrow. You can prepare your questions, you think through today, research your rooms, see what you have. And so the first part of the lecture will be color therapy, and then I will have more time for questions and answers. And if somebody wants to email 2 or 3 rooms, we can evaluate. I don't know if we could do more in 1.5 hours, but we can do it. Okay. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mandodari. It's very, very fascinating. Thank you for sharing. And we look forward for tomorrow.
Thank you.
So we say the prayer now to end. Om. So we pray for peace and health for everyone. Trayambakam yajamahe sugam dim pushtivadanam. Urvalkam evabandhanan machua muksya mamritan. Om Trayambakam yajamahe sugam dim pushtivadanam. Urvalkam evabandhanan machua muksya mamritan. Om Trayambakam yajamahe sugam dim pushtivadanam. Урвау камива банданан мричуа мукшия мамритан. Ом шанти, шанти, шанти. Ом боло садхуси шиванандамаски чай. Боло шри вишну деванандамаски чай. Харе ом татсат, thank you.
Ом
намачивая.
So now there's a break for all the students here. There's 4 p.m. there's a yoga class, and then 5:30 p.m. is a satsang, and then we have the schedule tomorrow also. So thank you.
What is the satsang?
Swami Dharmananda talking about the yoga health education program.
Okay, very good. Yeah, Om Namah Shivaya.